As you know, this is Thomas Berman, and he's going to be doing the renal part two lecture. If you have any questions, just let us know, okay?
Everybody, I'm Thomas. I've been hanging out in the back for the last few weeks. I work at Gaston Regional, the surgical intensive care unit. We're going to talk a little bit about renal failure. I've got a fun fact, I guess, an interesting fact anyways, about dialysis. First treatment for dialysis was performed by Dr. George Haas in Gießen, Germany in 1924. Patient didn't have a great outcome, but he did extend the life by a few weeks, so that was some progress made there. Just a little, I guess it's a motivational quote from Estee Lauder. I never dreamed about success, I worked for it. If you ever go to the SICU and I'm charging, I'm the one that always leaves a little joke up on the counter. They're always kind of horrible dad jokes, but they're usually there. So today's joke is, what does the nephrologist say to the non-compliant patient? I'll tell you at the end. Don't look it up now. It's not worth looking up now. It's not that funny. On the labs, I know that there's going to be some overlap between the stuff that I throw up and then the stuff that Wendy's already talked about. So GFR, creatinine, VWIN, potassium, sodium, phosphorus, calcium, mag, and it's not a lab, but your hourly urine output. Looking to keep an eye on those things. These are the numbers that we use at Gaston Regional. If my numbers are different than what your book says, please use your book. But I think they should be fairly close. GFR 90 to 120, creatinine 0.7 to 1.3 in men, and 0.6 to 1.1 in women. VON 6 to 24, potassium 3.5 to 5.2, sodium 135 to 145, phosphorus 3.4 to 4.5, calcium 8.5 to 10.3, mag 1.3 to 2.1, and then your hourly urine output 0.5 to 1 milliliter per kilogram per hour. What Wendy was saying earlier about the 30 an hour, that's really kind of drilled in, I know, like the 120 over 80 on the blood pressure is kind of drilled in, but it's just not the same for everybody. So you do have to kind of keep a close eye on that. So a lot of times in the units, if they have a Foley, they kind of have that flip-up Foley where they have a drip chamber on the front and then the large bag in the back. And that's so the nurses can kind of keep up a little bit tighter with the hourly urine output. So if you ever see those, just kind of pay attention to that. It's normally not just one big bag. It usually has that drip chamber on the front, so you can kind of keep up with that per hour. So question, a client with chronic renal failure has been prescribed calcium carbonate. What's the rationale for this medication? Is it for a gastric ulcer prevention, constipation, binds with phosphorus to lower concentration, or for tubular reabsorption of sodium? Acute renal failure patients often has hyperphosphatemia, and so they're kind of prescribed this to help improve excretion of the phosphorus. Normally they're given that with meals, like 30 minutes before the meal actually starts, but you'll see that quite often with those types of patients. Dialysis, in its most compact and basic form, dialysis is it's an artificial method to work as the kidneys. So it's going to remove metabolic waste, and it uses principles of osmosis and diffusion to get that done. So osmosis is a movement of a solvent across a semi-permeable membrane, and it usually works from a lesser concentration to a greater concentration. And then diffusion is spontaneous, and it's the movement of particles across a permeable membrane, and it works down a concentration gradient, so it goes from an area of higher concentration to an area of lower concentration. But those are the two principles that a dialysis works with. Risk factors for kidney disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, obesity, age, medical history, tobacco use can all be a factor with kidney disease. Diabetes is kind of a disease process that you'll see involved in a lot of different things. So if a patient has diabetes, you're going to see that pop up quite a little bit. Hypertension is a problem, heart disease, heart failure. A BMI of greater than 30, 30 or more, that's going to be a problem for kidney disease. Age of 60 or more, and then a family history of acute or chronic kidney disease can be an indicator as well. Not acute, but chronic kidney disease can be a problem. So if you want to keep up with that. These are just two types of dialysis machines. The one on the left is the Tablo, which is a newer device. That's what they use at Gaston Regional currently. And that device is used for regular hemodialysis. It's also used for CRRT. And then it's also indicated for use by the patient in the home. So it's kind of a all-around device. The device on the right there is a kind of a standard dialysis machine that you'll see in a dialysis clinic. And so it's just a little bit more, it's got some extra functionality that you might need in a dialysis clinic, but those are two that you'll see commonly. The two basic types of dialysis, hemodialysis, which is used to filter the blood, waste product. So to use the hemodialysis, you'll need a some sort of access, either like a surgically put in graft or fistula, permacath, something to that effect. And it's usually treated by the dialysis nurse itself. And then peritoneal dialysis, which mostly we see at the patient's home, but sometimes you'll see them in the hospital setting. If they're admitted and they're already doing peritoneal dialysis, sometimes they'll come in and we'll start that for them. That's usually started by the dialysis nurse, but at times we'll have to, the bedside nurse may have to start that. It's a fairly simple procedure then. But that usually requires a implanted catheter placed inside the abdominal cavity. A lot of patients like the peritoneal dialysis because it's a little easier on them, and if they do it at home, they can usually start it before they go to bed and then just let it work. The things you have to watch out for is on peritoneal dialysis, you cannot use that if it's an emergency situation. So if the patient has missed a treatment or they've been at home and they just didn't do it and then they come in and it's emergent, the peritoneal dialysis is not the best thing for an emergency situation. So hemodialysis, so the big things on that is it's extracorporeal, meaning that it filters it outside the body. You have to have the machine, the dialyzer, and it's working as the kidney. It's intermittent, so normally if a patient's on a dialysis machine, they might go to a dialysis clinic three times a week, and they might be 2 to 4 hours per treatment on that. It can filter water out through ultrafiltration, and then it filters out waste product like urea, nitrogen, and excessive electrolytes. The hemodialysis is usually for patients that are acutely ill and may just need some short-term dialysis. If you start hemodialysis, you don't necessarily have to stay on it the rest of your life. I know that's usually the case, but there are times where we're able to start it temporarily, allow things to heal, and then we're able to take it back off again. So that's just a little image of it. So the blood is pulled, it goes through the pump, and then through the dialysis machine, and then it's sent back to the patient. Different types of dialysis access right here. So the permacath is surgically implanted. It's usually tunneled. It goes under the muscle, and it's usually in place for about 12 months. It can be used for less than that, but 12 months is about the longest that we usually see that for. It can go under the IJ, you can go under the subfabian. And that type of line, it's a permacath. The nurse does not remove that. They go to surgery and have that removed. Vascath and a trialysis line. That could be used for a short-term or emergency treatment. You'll see a lot of trialysis lines placed. And we can place those at the bedside. The surgeon can come in and place that at the bedside or intensivist or whomever. So the trialysis line is, from a nurse's standpoint, it's nice as it has that third lumen. On the picture, it's along the right with the purple lumen in the middle. And so it works like a central line, so we're able to use it for drips or whatever that we need a central line for. This is an example of like a vascular access. So you might have a fistula, and a fistula is formed by taking the artery and the vein and combining them together. And when we do that, when it's done, it's still, you cannot access it. It takes 2 or 3 months for it to kind of like heal up. When it does, it's going to strengthen up the connection. And it's going to get a little bigger and strengthen up. So you could not use that for 2 to 3 months, and then you have to check with the doctor to make sure that it's available when that time has passed. The graft uses a piece of artificial tubing to connect the two together if the patient's not able to do the fistula. But you can use a piece of artificial tubing to get that accomplished, and that's inside the skin. It won't be on the outside of the inside. So sometimes you might have a patient comes in and they'll have several grafts or several access that's just it's just from years of using having dialysis completed to the point where access may not be the best. A lot of times your nephrologist doesn't want like a central line put in, like a PICC line on the other arm, just in case there's an emergency or that we have to switch over to the other arm for access. So if you ever have a patient that is a dialysis patient, just bear that in mind. If you ever need to get a PICC line and put something to that, they may not be thrilled with it. And then when you assess the grafts, you assess the thrill and the bruit. So feel the thrill and hear the bruit. All right. Indications. You can use dialysis for some drug overdoses in shock. We don't see a lot of drug overdoses that require dialysis, but we've had one or two that comes in for it. Drugs such as lithium, acetaminophen, barbiturates, antidepressants. If they come in for a significant overdose for that, you might see dialysis ordered for that reason. Sometimes they'll just do the regular hemodialysis. 2 or 3 times I've seen it, it's been the continuous renal replacement therapy. And then just the regular use for dialysis, just the buildup of toxins in the blood, and then for patients who aren't able to remove their own excess fluid. Contraindications. So hemodynamic instability is a problem. And when you hook up to the machine, you're pulling a large amount of blood out of the body, and it could take a minute for it to recirculate. Now, fluid's going in, but it's not blood, and sometimes that can cause a lower blood pressure. That might be a contraindication for that patient. And then some coagulopathy issues. We give heparin through the process of dialysis, but you can still have a hemorrhage if the patient's not suitable for it. So that sometimes is an issue. A lot of times, if it is an issue, they'll go on and start it anyways, because normally they have to have the dialysis. The risk versus reward is the reward is there. Assessment, you really want to know your patient if you're going to be involved with the dialysis. Even if you're not the dialysis nurse, you have to know your patient pretty well. You want to know the reason why they're going to have dialysis. You need to know their vital signs before, during, and after. You need to keep up with their trend of vital signs. If they've already had dialysis before, you may want to look to see what their trend was during dialysis, and you can anticipate any issues that may come up. The dialysis patient weight, that wet weight, that's their, normally it's their pre-dialysis weight, while they're still kind of fluid overloaded. Know what their intake and output is. You'll probably be doing strict eyes and nose, so just monitor that pretty carefully. And then the outcomes of the therapy, what's our goal? A lot of times The doctor will talk about how much fluid they're trying to pull, if they want to pull 2 liters or 3 liters, or if they're just trying to filter out. But you should kind of understand what the goal is and the length of time that they're going to be on the dialysis machine. So just kind of bring that in. With that, kind of understand when they're going to have dialysis scheduled, because it may affect what you give them as far as their medications go. A lot of times, if you have a patient on dialysis, it's fairly common for them to drop the blood pressure a little bit. So if they're kind of on the border, sort of blood pressure goes, you may want to hold their blood pressure medication and things like that. And if their dialysis is coming, like in the morning, you may want to hold all the medications. Most of those get filtered out. And the information I read on that is anywhere between 25 to 75% of the medication gets filtered out, depending on the settings of the dialysis machine and the specific patient and the exact medication. But it can filter out a significant amount. Post-dialysis, you still want to keep an eye on your vital signs every 15 minutes for an hour, and then 30 minutes for every 30 minutes for an hour, and then hourly after that. And then you should know what the patient's dry weight is or their weight after filtration. Complications. Dialysis disequilibrium, hypovolemia, hypotension. Not real common, but sometimes you can have hypertension, muscle cramps, angina, and dysrhythmias. And it's not really a complication, but most of your patients are cold during dialysis during that filtering process. The dialysis disequilibrium syndrome, it's kind of a group of symptoms that cause some cerebral edema, and it's caused by the rapid removal of the toxins in the bloodstream. It's a very significant issue, and you have to keep a close eye for that. But it can include a headache, a nausea, disorientation from the patient, blurred vision, confusion, seizures can occur, and the patient can be put into a coma from that as well. Continuous renal replacement therapy, or the CRRT. You might hear a nurse call it the CRRT. It's RRT. It's a continuous renal replacement therapy. This is a Prisma Flex machine that's up there now, and that's fairly common for CRRT. So it's very similar to regular hemodialysis as it's done extracorporeally, and you still have to have access to a dialysis site for that. It still uses osmosis and diffusion for the process to work. It's normally done over a longer period of time, most of the time it's done by just the bedside RN. So normally with regular dialysis, it takes between 2 and 4 hours. The CRRT is done between 20 to 24 hours for normally a couple of days at a time. And the primary indication for that is going to be hemodynamic instability or like low blood pressure goes. That's usually our biggest issue is the blood pressure. So if a patient's on one pressor, sometimes they can still run regular hemodialysis. But if they're on more than one, if they're on like levofed and vasopressin or something, then they usually want to go under the CRRT machine. It can be a little complicated, and you can make adjustments to the machine on the fly. Depending on what your settings are. Peritoneal dialysis. Peritoneal dialysis, again, we don't see that a whole lot in the hospital setting, but you may see that in the home. And if a patient's already on peritoneal dialysis, that we can do that in the hospital if that's what their preference is. But you have to assess the abdominal catheter. It uses the peritoneum as the membrane for the exchange of products. It's significantly slower than regular dialysis, and it can be done intermittently. There are patients who that have an order written as like PRN, so the patient understands when they need it. And it can be used for short-term dialysis or long-term dialysis, but not for emergency. Normally, it takes about 6 to 10 hours to complete a cycle. So that's a peritoneal dialysis machine. It helps warm the fluid. You don't have to have the machine. You can do it without the machine, but most of the patients that I've had that have peritoneal dialysis have a dialysis machine. It makes it just a little bit easier. Indications, the primary indication for that's going to be if the patient's choice, if that's what they wish to have. But they do have to have an intact abdominal cavity without adhesions or a significant amount of surgeries to it. It's relatively easy to teach for the patient. Repeated peritonitis, that's kind of a flub up. That's not an indication. That's a complication. I don't know why I put that up there. Procedure for that, you're going to warm the dialysis solution. It can be done by hand. It doesn't have to be hooked up to the machine. But the automated machine does make things a little bit easier. We need to make sure that when we're connecting up to it, that that we keep the tubes and the connections sterile. The dialysate is sterile, and it dwells for a prescribed amount of time. So you can program the machine for that. If you're at home doing it, you can use a stopwatch or an alarm or what have you. Dwells for a prescribed amount of time, and then the fluid is drained after that. It's usually a little bit milder than hemodialysis. The patients usually tolerate it pretty well, as long as when they're home and doing it on themselves, or if they have a spouse or whomever, that they keep it sterile. And again, the patients, a lot of times the patients prefer it just because they're able to do it at home while they're sleeping. They just plug into it and they go to sleep. They do kind of have to be cautious as they can rip things out in their sleep. So most of the time they're kind of self-aware of that. But occasionally that's when it's happening. All right, so that's kind of a visual for that. You can see that solution bag is on top, and that infuses into the abdominal cavity, and then it wells, and then after the dwell time, we open it up, and then it goes to the drainage bag. So the things you'll want to watch out for that are the vital signs, labs, the patient's weight again, making sure that the tubing for that is primed or flushed with dialysate, strict sterile technique. And then the dwell time is done at the precise time, as it can cause imbalances if you leave it on too long or too little. So a client with chronic renal failure has a venous access site for hemodialysis on their left forearm. What action will the nurse take to protect this access site? You want to protect the arm that has the shunt, so no blood pressures, no sticks on that arm. One of the answers was to irrigate with heparin. That's not something we would ever do with dialysis on. Complications, respiratory distress when the fluid is indwelling. So when we infuse the peritoneal dialysis, it's between 1 and 4 liters. Most of the time it's 2 liters. But while that fluid is going in, it could cause some respiratory distress, a lot of volume added to it. Infection is a significant, and oftentimes you'll see that's probably the number one issue of infection. Fluid retention, if it doesn't drain completely, the catheter can clot. You can have some hyperretention as well. Electrolyte imbalances, then some patients complain about pain and intolerance to the whole process. Peritonitis, the infection, inflammation of the peritoneum. A lot of times patients will complain of pain, abdominal tenderness, distension, rigidity, ileus, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, and temperature issues. You might see an increased white blood cell count. You might see a lower HNH. You may need to do an x-ray. You may give fluids or colloids, may need electrolyte replacements, pain medications or antibiotics. If it's significant enough, you're going to have to involve a surgeon and a surgeon help you with that. You may have a fluid volume deficit. loss of volume, may cause some dehydration, GI issues, renal loss, purge spacing. And the high risk groups for those are kind of similar for your other high risk groups. Very, very young, very old, ill, stroke patients, and such. If you do a fluid replacement, you may just do a normal saline or isotonic fluid. You can use half normal. Occasionally, you use D5 or LR. Then you may have to do some basic fluid management for that. Occasionally, you'll get an order for a colloid, albumin, head of starch, dextran. We don't usually use a lot of head of starch. That was a drug or medication that we used to use pretty often a while back, but since then, we usually use the albumin now. So you may see that more often than not. So you may have an issue with fluid volume excess or overload. And that can be caused by heart failure, renal failure, liver failure. Some medications will cause it as well. Interventions for that are usually trying to find the underlying cause of it. So if you have a patient that's got too much fluid volume, you may see a water and sodium restriction, diuretics, Lasix, hydrochlorothiazide, aldactone, mannitol, those may all be given on that. If you have a fluid restriction, whoever the doctor is that orders the fluid restriction, you need to find out if that's a PO fluid restriction or a total fluid restriction. Sometimes they'll give you an order for a 1 liter fluid restriction, and their IV fluids may be up greater than 1 liter, so find out for sure how they want to do that. If it's just a PO fluid restriction, that's usually what you can manage. Mannitol is a diuretic. We normally don't give that a whole lot for fluid volume excess. It's usually used for extra fluid on the brain, but sometimes we'll give it if it's a severe case. Psychosocial disease. So a lot of times if a patient's gonna start dialysis for the first time, they're a little bit in shock from that. And they generally need a little hope and a little encouragement from that. That just kind of general hope there. Not a lot. Decreased pain from the access site procedures. Long term, they just need kind of support for the whole process. Sometimes they'll need support going to and coming back from the clinic, and then financial issues are often a problem as well. Decision to terminate therapy. A lot of times that's kind of like kind of a heavy hitter if it's somebody who's determining for a loved one if they want to continue with the therapy or not. And those decisions are always tough, and you just have to work them as best as you can. So if you have a client who's diagnosed with chronic renal failure and they've recently begun dialysis, knowing that the client is at risk for dyspeptic lipidemia syndrome, the nurse assesses the client for what? Hypertension, tachy, and fever, hypotension, bradycardia, hypothermia, restlessness, irritability, weakness, and headache, deteriorating level of consciousness, and twitching. The twitching could be some seizure activity, and you can honestly see that if you're pulling too much or you have a significant electrolyte shift. And that's either like if we've removed too much or you can also see that if we've corrected an imbalance too quickly as well. The nurse prepares to instill dialysate for a client receiving peritoneal dialysis. Which nursing action is the priority? Ensuring that the drainage collection bag is below the level of the abdomen, place the client in a semi-Fowler's position, reporting the characteristics of the dialysate, or using sterile technique when spiking the bag of dialysate. So it's going to be using sterile technique. They're already at a very high risk for infection. So we make sure we're using that correctly. Stuff is going to be a case study. you're working on the cardiovascular ICU unit. You have a 68-year-old male patient. The patient's 70 inches long, weighs 275. The patient post-op day number 4, and they had a 4-vessel CABG. The patient has a history of hypertension, hyperlipidemia, benign prostate hyperplasia, and type 2 diabetes requiring oral and sub-Q treatments. In the report, the outgoing CBICU nurse tells you that the patient on post-op day 1 required 2 units of packed red blood cells, 2 doses of 25-gram, 500-milliliter albumin, as the CBP was low at 4 and the BP was low to submarginal. On post-op day 2, the patient went from normal sinus rhythm to atrial fibrillation and was started on IV amiodarone bolus and then a drip, and then PO metoprolol. On post-op day 3, the drip was discontinued and we just started PO instead. The outgoing CBICU nurse tells you all these things in report and then mentions that urine and Foley catheters will be doing 5 to 30 an hour for their shift. After that nurse leaves and you begin your shift, based off the report that you received, what's your initial concern? The overall urine output of 30 an hour is too low for a patient with this weight. The expected urine output should be about 62.5, which 30 is less than half of that. So what would be the simplest thing to check to see if the urine output is right? Like what would be the very easiest thing?
Bladder scan?
Yeah, but you can do a bladder scan. So you can check a Foley catheter before a bladder ultrasound to check for high residual body urine. So sometimes they can get kinked. We use those stat blocks. Sometimes they'll get folded up. Sometimes the patient's position just needs to be adjusted on that. So yeah, you can do that. That's very interesting. So let's say the Foley catheter is not kinked and everything seems to be flowing smooth. You flush it out. You don't see any issues with that. So after 4 hours, urine output drops. It's now 100 milliliters for the 4 hours. What's the safest thing to do for the patient? What might you anticipate? But it went from 30, now it's down to 25. What do you think the safest thing is to do for the patient? So we call the doctor and anticipate questions regarding what the intake is, a PO, IV intake, what the drainage has been from the drainage systems, if they have a chest tube, JP drains, or what have you. The doctor is going to ask about vital signs and trends, if we can do a CBP or not, and then the amount we can order for labs. So we'll say that you got an order for some labs and you've got the results, and the ones that kind of concern you are potassium 5.6, sodium of 132, blood sugar at 219, BUN of 89, and creatinine 3.9. Out of those labs there, what do you think puts the patient at the most risk? Potassium. So potassium at that level can start causing some lethal arrhythmias, and so that would put the patient at the most risk. So let's say that, what might you think you would do for a potassium at that level? So you might stop any IV fluids containing potassium, you might get an order for Lasix, and then potentially an order for KX later with Kelma. We'll see that a lot. So let's say you get an order for Lasix at 40 IV push now, and then a gram of KX late, and then repeat labs in 2 hours and report the results. So you give the dose of Lasix, and you notice that the blood pressure is starting to decline and is currently 90 over 60. You recheck the blood pressure and see that it's down to 84 over 52. You call the doctor and let him know, and the doctor gives you an order for a dopamine drip. You start the drip and titrate the order. And as you're titrating the dopamine, your nurse neighbor, who's just started, asks you why the doctor gave you an order for dopamine. What would you tell the nurse? So, dopamine can treat hypertension, it can increase cardiac output, it can dilate renal arteries, it can increase the urine output, it can protect the kidneys. At the required time, you order a set of labs and you report to the doctor that potassium is down 4.5, sodium is 136, BUN is 94, creatinine is 4.1, and you tell the doctor that the urine output has decreased to a total of 40 for 2 hours, so down to 20 an hour now. So sometimes it won't. Like you want it to be the fix, like regularly, but sometimes it won't. You end your shift and you report off to the next nurse. They're an experienced ICU nurse, When you come back the next day, you find that the CV surgeon had come to speak to the patient, and they had placed a right subclavian permacath. You review the labs, and you see that potassium has started to go up again to 4.9, and the BUN is 95. Creatinine is holding at 4.1, and you see that the previous nurse obtained a consent for hemodialysis. You also know that there are new orders for a 1 liter PO fluid restriction, and that the patient is upset. And as you talk to the patient, try to foster comfort to the patient asks you, what does AKI mean? The patient states that the doctor or the nurse kept referring to AKI, but he doesn't know what it means. He's also distraught having to spend the rest of his life connected to the dialysis machine. And so what are some things you can say to the patient to help keep them calm?
It's not necessarily
for life. So a lot of times you'll see that with the patients. For whatever reason, the doctor will come in and the patient will be smiling and nodding the whole time. And then when the doctor leaves, the patient has a thousand questions for you. Acute kidney injury for AKI, and we can talk to the patient about that. And then we need to explain why he needs to have dialysis. We don't want to provide false hope to the patient, but we do want to let them know that it's possible that, that he might not have to have dialysis forever, and just, he might just need it for a temporary amount of time while his kidneys heal, and then it's possible that he will no longer need it. We do want to talk to the patient about this. So the patient's relieved to hear that. Thank you. An hour after being on dialysis, the dialysis nurse asks for assistance with the patient. When you walk into the room, you see that the patient's sounding very sleepy, and that you see the blood pressure is now showing 62 over 48. The dialysis nurse states that they may have pulled fluid too aggressively. The dialysis nurse pauses the dialysis treatment, but the pressure doesn't improve. So you call the CV surgeon and explain the situation. So you're given a stat order for phenylephedrine, and you start that drip and titrate it up. And the patient's blood pressure starts to get up to 95 over 55 with a MAP of 68. Because the patient's now on dopamine and phenylephrine, what change might you anticipate to their dialysis treatment? So we might change it from dialysis to CRRT, because the CRRT is a little bit slower, and they're on two pressors now. So the doctor speaks to the patient and the family. They order the CRRT. The family asks what the difference is. What are some things you can tell them between dialysis and CRRT? Longer.
Might be easier on the patient.
So remember, if this was a situation, and sometimes you'll see this exact situation, that patient had already had a fair amount of anxiety from being worried that he's connected to the dialysis machine, and we told him that he might not be connected to it forever, but then we started a machine on him that's going to be on there for 20 to 24 hours at a time. So you do have to provide a little more comfort for that. But yeah, you're gonna explain to him that his blood pressure is a little unstable, and so the CRRT is able to pull out a full rate. But in this situation, after 24 hours of CRRT, the patient's lab values start to normalize, and we're able to turn off the DO drip. And then after an additional 12 hours, we're able to turn the dopamine drip off. So after that, we no longer have to run the CRRT, and we transition back to straight dialysis. And then the patient's urine output has started to improve. And after two additional treatments of dialysis, the patient's lab values start to normalize and are well controlled, with a return of adequate amount of urination. So the patient looks very successful. And so you ask yourself, you don't have to answer out loud, but if the patient is preparing for discharge and the patient's family goes up to you and thanks you for your nursing care, and they ask you what are some advice you can give the patient regarding kidney function, what are some things you might tell them? A lot of times they'll ask you that. They want to know what we do to prevent this. And that's kind of like really one of the best times to give that information is when it's kind of fresh in their minds, and that they're more agreeable, I guess, to hear what the information is. So do provide that information to them. What does the nephrologist say to non-compliant patients? You're in trouble. I
chef the ring election.